Thank you, Judy. I found that very interesting that we're in a death-denying society and all the movies have death in them. It's a disconnect for me. I want to remind you that we do have book sales. Steve Panlatt's book, Life After Diagnosis, is available in the lobby, or right there, whatever you call that, directionally impaired. And Dr. Zitter's book, Extreme Measures, will be available at the reception for sale. One small problem is they can't accept credit card. They will accept cash or check. So, and I'm willing to front some money for a small fee. Just saying. So I want everybody to stand up. And this morning we heard a lot about stretch, that's right, stretch, bend and stretch, reach for the sky, stand on tippy toes, oh so high. Okay, that's enough of that. So what we do in palliative care is really important. And we heard this morning that relationship is really important. So I want you to turn to the person beside you and thank them for what they do. Thank them for their heart. And if you feel so inclined, give them a hug. Okay, so one of the most interesting studies. Hello. Okay, you can stop thanking each other now. Thank later at the reception. Good grief. They told me I had to keep this running on time. One of the most fascinating studies I heard about was no, remain standing. I didn't tell you could sit down. Come on, people, pay attention. It's a tough crowd. One of the most fascinating studies was that in order to be fully functioning, actualized people, you need 12 or 13 hugs a day. So I would encourage you, this is a good group of people who like to give hugs. So I would encourage you to do that. So I would like to know, anyone who traveled less than 100 miles, sit down. Okay, good. If you traveled less than 200 miles, sit down. So we've had people coming a long way. Anywhere in California, sit down. And those of you who've come from outside of the state, we thank you immensely for coming and joining us. So our next session will be moderated by Devon Dabbs, who is CCC's Vice President of Pediatric Programming and Education. In this role, Devon focuses on issues impacting children with serious illness through research and public policy initiatives. Devon was the co-founder and executive director of the Children's Hospice and Palliative Care Coalition before it merged with Coalition for Compassionate Care in the fall of 2015. You're going to lead a panel on, which will explore when pediatric patients become engaged young adults. Devon?
Three. I'm up to three.
Wait, I was part of a contest? Wait,
No, you have to get 12 hugs.
Oh, okay, good. Hey, I like it. I like it, 12 hugs. I'm up for that. All right. Well, first of all, thank you all for being here. I am thrilled to actually be moderating this panel. And I would like to introduce you to two amazing young adults who have graciously agreed to come here and answer your questions and to have a conversation with you about what it's like to grow up with a life-threatening pediatric condition. And also then, what it's like to suddenly become a young adult with a pediatric life-threatening condition. So without further ado, Rachael Goldring and Charlie Blotner. Hello? Oh, okay, now you can, I can hear me. You can hear me? All right. So I wanted to kind of give you a little idea of how this panel came about. As Judy and Jim both mentioned, we formally partnered with the coalition about 2 years ago. And the reason behind that was because we realized how much synergy there was between our work. That a lot of what the coalition was doing with adults and seniors synergized so well with the work that we were doing with children and adolescents and young adults. And after we made this commitment to really formalize our agreement and come together, one of the first things we wanted to do was to develop a pediatric track at the annual summit. We wanted to have an opportunity for people to come together and network and share resources and ideas, because the reality is that there is no way that we can provide the community-based hospice and palliative care services for all the children in California without you. We need adult care providers that become more competent, have more confidence, and be committed to providing care for children in their communities. So thank you for being here. Thank you for listening. I sat in on one of our breakout sessions and I loved it because we had several people there who were adult care providers saying, tell me how we do this. Tell me how we get started. Who can I talk to? And those are the conversations that we need to be having. So kudos to all of you for being willing to have those conversations. Rachael and Charlie are here today. Claire Wineland was also supposed to join us. Claire Wineland is another amazing young advocate and champion who has cystic fibrosis. But unfortunately, Claire was also hospitalized a couple of times this year. It's been a rough year with the flu, and she had a really difficult time of it and was not able to join us here in Sacramento. But we really wanted, Charlie and Rachael and I talked about it, and we're like, we gotta get Claire in here somehow. So Claire does video blogging. And actually, one of her blogs was kind of the inspiration behind this panel. So we would like to show you Claire's blog, Dying 101. So with that, we're gonna start off our session with a little word from Claire Wineland.
So here's a little glimpse of my mind and the craziness that goes on in there. It's not a place you really want to be at. So whether it is by CF, old age, in your bed, surrounded by people that love you, or by zombie apocalypse, we are all going to die. So now that that's out of the way, how do we actually deal with death? How do we confront it? And how do we not let it control us? Well, as a sick kid who's personally dealt with death my entire life, here are some tips for how to properly kick the bucket. Or properly think about it. Properly, how to, because you know, I'm not giving you tips on how to die. So here are some tips on how to deal with our impending death. My first tip, and I honestly think this is the most important of them all, is to think about it. Don't let it be this really far off, scary thing that may or may not happen, that we can't discuss, that we shouldn't talk about with other people. It's happening. It's gonna happen. We're all going to die, and thinking about it is actually the best way to cope with it and the best way to not let it control you. Because when you think about it, when you actually really spend time, like, I suggest actually mentally walk through your own death. I mean, as insane as that is, just not necessarily the circumstances, not where or how or when or any of that, but just the feeling of actually realizing that you are going to die right now, and then go through that in your head. And the more you do it, the more you think about it, the more you realize, oh, I really am going to be gone one day, the less it scares you, and the more comfortable you become with the topic. And then when you're comfortable with the topic, other people will become comfortable with the topic, and then we'll stop being such losers afraid of something completely normal. So I like to talk about something called the bucket list misconception, which it's this idea that if you know you are gonna die, you have this urge to like go out and conquer the world and like go bungee jump and, you know, skydive and swim with the eels, and you know what I mean? The truth of the matter is when you realize that you're gonna die, the biggest thing, at least for me and a lot of other people that I've talked to, the biggest thing is you just want to live life slowly. You just want to enjoy it. So my lesson here is don't let death make decisions for you. The point shouldn't be to try and just cram everything out before we die, because then what we're creating isn't worth creating. We shouldn't really be doing things in our life just because we may die soon, because we're all gonna possibly die soon. So if we live our life making decisions and choices based off of that, then the things we're making aren't quite worth making. I feel like the stuff worth doing in your life is the stuff that you're called to do because you feel like the world needs it, not because you just wanna cram it out before you die. Okay, another one that I think is really fun is to plan your funeral. Now please don't go running for the hills. You don't want your funeral to be this weird thing that like your gross Aunt Mildred plans for you. You want it to be something that you plan and you create and you have a say in the matter. Also, it helps you realize that life is still gonna go on after you're dead. I mean, these people that you love, the people in your life are still gonna be there and they're still gonna mourn you. And so to kind of, I feel like actually what's really fun is to involve your family in it. I did this when I was around 14, me and my mom sat down and we were like, okay, if you really do die, what do you want? You know, and my thing was, I said, I want to be burned and then split up into three different piles. And one of those piles goes into these little jars, and I want to give the jars to different family members, and it's gonna have a place on the world on each jar, and they have to travel to that place and go and dump it. And so then it's forcing them to actually travel. And then some planted in a tree, and then some put into paint, and then that paint used to paint some cool picture. Like, come up with interesting, cool things that you want done. If you want to be buried, come up with like a funny eulogy that you write yourself and you have someone read. You know, like plan really cool, funky music, cool colors, have it in weird places, like have a funeral in a public place or something. Like if you just have like, I thought this was interesting, someone told me they wanted to have their funeral done like a flash mob when flash mobs were still like a really big thing, like have a flash mob for your funeral. Do something interesting, do something to celebrate your life and not just mourn it. Another part of the planning out your funeral is try planning out your last words. This is actually really cool. You can go around and like just ask people in your life, like what would be the most epic like last words for you to say? And then write those down and have like a little book of like possible last words for you to say. Just make sure that when you're actually dying, you really gotta remember this. I used to always do that. When you go into surgery and they put you down under anesthesia, there's kind of a moment of panic where you realize you could easily die on the operating table and this could be it, and you're going, and they're medically inducing you under. And so I used to always think of, what would I say? What would be my last words? I still haven't figured it out. It's also interesting to read other people's last words, you know? See like what other people leave the world with of them, you know? And some of them are hilarious. Make absolutely no sense. There's actually like a whole website of it too, if you just feel like, you know, if you're bored on a Sunday, go read people's last words. And then, you know, maybe one day your last words will be up there with famous last words. Something to think about. Something to be excited about for your death. Mm-hmm. This is my notebook, by the way, guys. This is where I have all of my like cool video planning stuff. Like, ooh, fancy. So fancy. All right.
Claire Wineland. So if you want to see more of her video blogs, you can go to theclarityproject.org. She is an amazing young advocate for hospice and palliative care. And she is joined by two dear friends, Charlie Blotner and Rachael Goldring. So I would like to give Rachael and Charlie a chance just to introduce themselves, tell you a little bit about their journey. And then we're going to open this up. This is a conversation. So I have a couple of questions, and I appreciate people that actually added questions to the box, because while I love fresh air, I am no Terry Gross, so I need all the help I can get on this. But we have mics on both sides of the room, so I encourage you, if you have a question, please step forward. We don't want this to be a one-sided conversation. We want to really engage in some really honest, candid discussion about what it's like to grow up with a life-threatening condition, but also what it's like now to be transitioning into adulthood, and both the challenges from the patient perspective, but also, quite frankly, some of the challenges from the provider perspective. So Charlie, I'm going to let you kick us off and tell us both a little bit about yourself and then why you're here today, why you actually agreed to come and take these questions.
Yeah, so can everyone hear me all right? Yeah, okay. So I'm Charlie. I am 21, turned 22 next month, and I'm a social work student based out of Arizona. And my medical history of sorts was being diagnosed with a grade 2 astrocytoma when I was 13 years old and in the 7th grade. And it was a little weird because I didn't actually receive any treatment for that of sorts until I was 21 years old, or sorry, not 21 years old, 17 years old. So we had a watch and wait period of almost 5 years. And during that time, I didn't really receive any palliative care of sorts. And so when I first learned what palliative care was, I thought, wow, that would have been really great and really helpful to have. And I think coordinating that care definitely would have helped me kind of process and also definitely just have better care and managing epilepsy that also has happened as a result of that brain tumor. Just it would have made a world of difference. So that's why I'm here today, and that's the perspective that I have to share.
Okay, can you hear me? I'm pretty loud, so I don't know if I even need the mic. My name is Rachael Goldring. I'm 24 years old. I am from Clovis, California. Well, yeah! I was born with a congenital heart defect, pulmonary atresia, and mine was on the spectrum of pretty severe. I was born without my pulmonary valve. And I had my first open heart surgery at 9 months at UCLA. And that I was actually the youngest in 1992 to ever survive that open heart surgery. Now they're doing it like the next day you're born. So great job, technology. I had my first 3 open heart surgeries at UCLA, and we thought that was the worst of it. It wasn't. I ended up developing pulmonary hypertension secondary to my heart defect, and I'm basically running on one lung. I also have an immune deficiency disease called CVID, or common variable immunodeficiency, which is not common at all, and that was, yeah, kind of dumb name, but yeah, so I developed that at 18. And then I went to Fresno State, and I did about a semester there. Could not continue because of my health. So like Charlie here, but I'm online, I'm at ASU, But then, I got overdosed with prednisone, gained 60 pounds in 3 weeks, and was in the ICU for about a month at two different locations, Stanford, CVICU, love them, and also Valley Children's in the Central Valley. So I started this, well, I'm a part of palliative care from my physician, Dr. David Sein, who's right there. And it is an amazing program. So this is why I'm here. I love the program, I love what it does, and I love what it's just about. So.
Thank you both. So I thought we would just kick it off following Claire's video. I'm curious if you ever had those conversations about death and dying, either with your medical team or your family or friends, and what that was like.
All right. So I've actually never really had any conversations about death and dying with my medical team, which you would think would be pretty common or straightforward going into neurosurgery, something for a brain tumor. You would think that someone would want to know, well, if this goes south, what are your preferences? But that didn't happen. So I had that surgery when I was 17 at UCSF, and I would imagine that the reason why that conversation didn't happen would be because I was under 18 years old. But the conversation didn't happen with my parents either, which was surprising. And when I look back now and I think, well, was that because this was me coming out of state, being from Michigan originally? I flew to UCSF to have this surgery as kind of a one and done. I just did kind of a drive-by, had the surgery, and then I went back to Michigan. And I didn't really continue care there. And so I wondered, well, was it because I wasn't really maintaining any palliative care there, or there wasn't really any ongoing care there? Was that why? But I think regardless of if patients are going to be ongoing there or not, I think it's still very important to have conversations about death and dying, regardless of their age as well. And I think also regardless of if a patient's a child, if they're an adolescent, if they're a young adult, if they're 50 years old, everyone has concerns about death of dying. And whether those conversations happen or not, the concerns are still going to be there.
I'm sorry. He had such a good answer. I gotta get the point.
I love it. You're listening. That's good.
No,
good. You're setting a very good example here.
Thank you.
So the question was, if you ever had a conversation with your medical team or family or friend about death and dying, and if so, what was that like?
Got it. Okay. Yes. Since day one, I knew that my CHD was potentially deadly, it runs in our family. So I had an uncle who passed away at 4 months old with my defect in 64. But it wasn't until I went to a camp for kids with heart defects that I really opened up and I really understood the whole aspect of what it really means to accept it. So death, for me, I have many friends. One of my best friends about 6 years ago passed away while he was undergoing a open heart surgery for 17 hours. He had a massive stroke and never woke up. So I've had many friends pass away, but when I was 16, I call it the depression, realizing that mommy and daddy, it's not gonna be okay, and that there is a big risk of death. And talking to my family, my dad was a healthcare attorney at the time, and it was an open conversation. I ended up going to a psychologist for it, and what we really took away from the psychologist and my camp and talking about it was that death is not a scary thing. Death is a beautiful thing, because if you've lived a life and if you've lived it well, it's okay. And I, yes, thank you. Yes. And having my friends pass away, and having my dad, and having my mom, and having my two older sisters talk about it, it became normal. Death is normal in my family, and it's okay to talk about it. It's not this taboo of, ooh, I don't want to talk about it. It's so scary. It's going to happen, like Claire said. I mean, you know, but we're just a little bit more, you know, we were just more exposed to it, I think, and we will always be exposed to it because this is our reality, and this will be our reality until we die. So, yes, I have talked about death, and I do have a advanced directive. Directive.
And we actually had this conversation a little on the side earlier. And so Rachel and Charlie's experiences with advanced directives are a little bit different. So we were going to get to that a little later, but I think you've now introduced it beautifully. Yes, so do you mind sharing with us, both of you, sharing with us your experiences with advanced directives?
Yeah. So we were talking about it in the other room, and so it's interesting because Rachel obviously has spent a lot of time crafting and working on hers with several professionals, where mine, on the other hand, I actually just printed it off the internet and filled it out this past week, when literally a couple days ago, I was here visiting my sister, and I decided that I wanted her to be my healthcare proxy, because I know that she and my parents have kind of different perspectives and have different wishes than what I would want for myself at end of life, or if something were to go wrong in my treatment. And I think being cognizant of that at any age, and also knowing that, wow, this is something that I should think about, even if I'm not in a health crisis right now. You know, being over 18 years old, I now have the power to make these decisions for myself, and I have the autonomy to do that. And because this wasn't a conversation that was had before when I was younger, this is something that I can take in my own hands now, and with the power of Google, is something that I can find for myself.
I did not know that you filled it out like last week.
Yeah, literally a couple days ago.
Well, congratulations. Welcome to the team. It's great to have you. Mine was not last week. It was actually when I was going through a medical crisis. Like I said, I was overdosed with prednisone. And I was transferred from Valley Children's to Lucille Packard in the ICU, CVICU. And there, my pressures for my lungs were pretty, like, 90% or higher. And so I didn't know this, but I was actually being evaluated for a heart and lung transplant at that time. I also was, they suspected a blood clot on my pulmonary valve. And so I was on high doses of warfarin, Coumadin, and I was bleeding out of everything. It was pretty high. But no, so I was supposed to get a heart cath, so I had to get on this Coumadin, you know, because they were afraid. And so they said, you know what, well, in the meantime, you got to do your advanced directive. And I'm like, what? I don't really want to do it. And my dad said, no, Rachel, it's a good thing. And like I said, he was a healthcare attorney at the time, but now he works at Valley Children's. And so him and I sat there with the social worker for about 3 hours on my bed, and she went through everything. I mean, every little detail. One request, and my eyes. I don't want to know where they go. I don't like eyes, so it freaked me out. But everything else, you know, donate it to science, donate it wherever you want. But my eyes, I don't want to know. So that's what I said. Ugh, eyes are disgusting, I'm sorry. But the social worker and this is not how, you know, it usually goes when you're filling out one of these. She spent 3 hours with us while my dad and I cried and cried on my bed. But at the end, and when I realized after getting off all the drugs, it was the control that I had. The only control I had in that bed that day and for an entire month. And I took back my control. And so I think it's a very important, it's very important, and yeah, that's all I've got to say. But yeah.
So anybody else in this room that does not have an advanced care directive, you have no excuse now.
Yeah.
Just going on record.
Yeah.
So again, I do want to encourage you, if you have questions, please come up to the mic. We'd love to have you gather in and be part of this conversation. I see a couple of people coming up. I have one quick question. I actually got here from someone in the audience asking, you know, people always say they're so afraid of saying the wrong thing. Is there really a wrong thing to say, or is there not? That was the question.
Do you want us to answer that?
I do.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
No, I just wanted to ask the question. You can move on now.
I think it's always important to keep language developmentally appropriate and to just always keep that in mind, but to also remember that just having the conversation, just any conversation, and bringing the topic up, we're thinking about it. We've been thinking about it, and a lot of times we're just afraid to bring it up because we know that our parents are afraid of it. And so they haven't been talking about it, and they haven't brought it up, and so we don't want to bring it up because we know that they're afraid of it. But something, you know, I read a really great article recently, and I have a feeling she's probably in the room somewhere, Dr. Jessica Zitter. She wrote about how, you know, we have sex ed, but why don't we have death ed? And so I think... You know, I think that's so true. And part of that, I think part of that death ed can come from our physicians or from our social workers or from whoever patients are seeing on that regular basis or from that quick check-in, and to kind of just take the temperature of the room and see, you know, what are your thoughts on this, or have you been thinking about what these symptoms might mean for your future? Or earlier in the session I went to earlier, we talked about what's the role of the social worker in palliative care, and a lot of times it kind of came up that when kids ask, "Am I dying?" we're not really asking, "Am I dying?" But it's asking, "Well, what do these symptoms really mean?" Or "What are my parents really saying?" And it's trying to figure out what questions are kids really asking, and just trying to get to that real point of that.
Okay. I'm gonna go a different direction with this.
Okay.
Sorry, but about dying, yeah, ask us whatever you wanna ask us, I mean, whatever. But I'm more of, you know, you can't really say the wrong thing. Sorry, doctors, I'm gonna say something, and nurses. When you're actually meeting us for the first time, that's when it counts on saying the right thing from the wrong thing, because if you say the wrong thing, I'm not gonna trust you. I mean, that's just it. I've seen so many physicians in my life. I have heard it all. This is our reality. That we're living this. We don't get to go home and just, you know, close the file or close the encyclopedia of our health history. You know, this is our reality. We're living with this, and we will always live with this, and the effects and everything that comes with it. So. Here, I mean, you could say the wrong thing. I don't know what you could say that's wrong, but that's just my opinion. So, yeah, ask away.
So I have just one quick follow-up question to you, Rachael, then on that. Is, so it's hard to know what the wrong thing is,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yeah.
So what is it then that a new physician or nurse that's coming in to meet you for the first time, what do you want or what do you need to hear?
Don't assume that you know us. Don't assume that you've had this case before, because every case, I don't care if you've seen someone with pulmonary atresia and pulmonary hypertension and CVID together, you've not seen me. My case is very rare. Their case is very rare. And every other case you will see is very rare. We're individuals. We're not just one case. And I think that's, listen and understand before you make an assumption and before you just listen to us. That's all we want, because we don't really get heard very much. And with our health, this is our, I mean, I call, this is how I put it. This is my career. I am a full-time patient, and I'm a full-time advocate for myself and for others. And so this is my career, and this is my life. This is, and this is my control. So yeah, I think just listen, and don't assume that we're all the same. Don't assume you've had the case before, because you haven't. I mean, it's, yeah, so we're very different.
Beautiful.
So you got a 50-50 chance that I'm going to pick you next. Start here.
Thank you so very, very much for representing something that we all need to understand. I'm a retired oncologist and had a patient with a low-grade glioma. Did not require treatment immediately, but there was a chance that it could become a higher grade brain tumor. And she was 30, and she and her husband were talking about whether or not, because there was uncertainty in her future, she should have a child. And I asked her a question, asked her whether she played checkers, and she had, and I asked her if she moved the pieces in the back row out. Because if you do that, your opponent can get a king. You may not understand checkers.
I don't.
That was Nixon's dog. In any event, it had to do with risk taking. So I asked her, do you play to win, or do you play not to lose? Ultimately, she did have a child. I don't think everyone has your sang-froid about encountering death as a, you know, what do we want for lunch? So what would you say to someone who was still frightened of their mortality?
I like that you bring up this particular case that is also a low-grade astrocytoma, or low-grade glioma, because that is essentially what my tumor was. And when I was first diagnosed, I was very much so frightened, and I lived in fear, really, for those first couple of years, thinking that I had a ticking time bomb in my head. And because I went almost 5 years without treatment, really, for the tumor, I was terrified. And I didn't make a lot of decisions or do a lot of things that I probably should have done. Or even in college, after the first couple of years, I thought that I definitely didn't think that I would graduate this May. I did not think that I would make it to my sophomore year of college. I just assumed that I would die. I assumed that I would have a recurrence based off of the literature that I had read, based off of the different stats that I had seen. And I think part of that also had to do with the general population's attitude towards brain tumors, because there are a lot of misconceptions about brain tumors. And I think a lot of what we as patients, how we live our lives, has to do with how our friends view us and how our families view us and how they see our futures. And so I think it's really important when talking to patients to also ask how does your family see you, how do your friends see you, and how are those conversations going, and what do those look like? Are you all kind of on the same page, or what are those dynamics, and how's that going? Because I know once I kind of surrounded myself with other people living with brain tumors and other people who certainly saw themselves having futures, I found myself having possibility models, and having those possibility models definitely allowed me to now be in the mindset of where I am today.
Thank you so very much.
Rachael, did you have anything you wanted to add?
Kind of. I heard a phrase or a saying, what fear? Or if you're afraid of heights, are you really afraid of heights or are you afraid of falling? And I think fear in itself, I think you have to understand all the aspects, all the components of what you are dealing with. And then, and only then, you can really start to not get over fear, because I mean, I'm still scared of dying. I'm scared of leaving my family, but I'm at peace with it. So, I mean, I don't have a direct answer, but I mean, I'm still scared, but I know that I've done everything in my power, and my physicians and the hospitals I go to and my nurses and everyone, we've done our best. And, you know, if it, you know, my family's gonna live on and that's okay. But yes, so, you know, I'm still scared, but I'm at peace with it now, so.
Okay. Thank you.
No.
Thank you for waiting.
My pleasure. Thank you both for your courage and willingness to talk to some of us older people who, as a pediatric nurse and pediatric oncology, I know I've learned my best lessons much more than I ever got out of a book from you. And I really appreciate that education that you've given us. You brought up something really important to me because it's come up recently twice, and that's that bringing up subjects where I do see, I talked with a young guy on his bedside when his mom and the rest of the family went off to talk to the doctors. And, you know, 20 people have been in, all have left in tears. So he's pretty, got a good clue what's going on, but, you know, don't talk to him. Don't say anything about what's going on. That happens a lot. And the other was an 18-year-old who had just turned 18, and the discussion about talking to him versus talking to the parents. But as one of the providers, we often feel stuck in the middle because either the message from the parents, like you referred to, is we don't want to go there. By the way, I loved that. Please tell Claire I love that sign behind her. Yeah, go there. And the kids who seem to get much more scared by the things we don't talk about, and there's all the whispering that's going on in the hallways. If you had ideas as young adults now, mm-hmm. how do we talk to kids, older kids, who do understand, and how do we talk to the parents who maybe aren't there yet? How do we bridge that gap that you referred to just a little while ago?
Can I go first? I have a really good one, I'm sorry. Okay, this is like my specialty, okay? Because I was there. I've had CHD my entire life. So I've been, you know, I've basically been in the hospital my entire life as well. But it was I was 15 years old, and it was the realization depression I was talking about. And I was in my, I think, I should be in speech therapy, but I'm not. But I was in one of my physician's offices, and she accidentally said, oh yeah, so when are you getting your heart cath? Isn't it scheduled? And I went, what are you talking about? What heart cath? And sorry, Dad. My parents lied to me. They did not tell me I needed a heart cath. And a heart cath for a congenital heart patient is very, very, very scary because we know what also comes along with a heart cath. We are probably having open heart surgery as well. It is scary. And I was 15 years old. I had no idea, so I did not trust my parents after that. I could not trust them. That's when I went into my deep depression, and I got a psychologist who I love and who's been with me forever, and she knows my case, and everyone knows my case, and, you know, and I just could not trust my parents. Anything they said, oh, I was like, nope, you're lying. You're lying. How can I trust you after you lied to me? Not telling the patient is the worst possible thing you can do to that patient. Not just because it's their life, it's their body, but it's also the trust factor. And it took me a very long time. My dad can, you know, it took me a very long time to trust them again. And it was only after I had the heart cath, after I talked to everybody involved. And I even got mad at my pediatric cardiologist. I'm like, well, how could you not have told me? This is my life. I'm the one who's going to be on that table. And he said, well, we didn't want to scare you. Okay, so not telling me is like, yeah, one day we're just going to go to the hospital and oops, you're getting a cath, sorry, I didn't tell you. No. We need to process it. So I think, and if I'm answering your question, I hope so. You need to talk to the patient. Not telling the patient is the worst thing you could do. And yes, they might react, and yes, they might get scared and mad and whatever, but it's better for them because they need to process it. Trust me, they need to process it. And now they talk to me. They don't talk to my parents, or they will talk to me and my parents in the same room, but now I'm 24 and I'm engaged. You know, now they talk to my fiance as well, but not telling the patient is the worst possible thing you can do.
I want to counter that.
No?
Yeah.
Oh, bring it on.
So I want to counter that point because, so we have ethics involved when your patient is under 18 and the parent is saying, no, I don't want my child to know. Mm-hmm. And so obviously you have to respect the parent's wishes there, even if that goes against every fiber in your being. As you all know that. And some patients might not be like Rachael, who is clearly an information seeker. Some patients might be information avoiders and do not want to know what is going on. And hearing that information might be terrifying for them. Yeah. And so I'm also an information seeker. But there are quite a few patients I've volunteered with who would just melt if they knew the kind of information that you and I knew. And so it's tough to kind of have a one-size-fits-all answer for that. And I think you also have to utilize the resources in place if you have a child life specialist at your hospital, which not all do, unfortunately. Or social workers, obviously, hopefully there are, I mean, I would imagine there are a ton of social workers in the room, but to just try to utilize the resources that are in place if you can, and build those bonds and build that rapport where you can, and just unfortunately hope for the best if and when you can.
Okay, he does make a great point. I have to give him that. So yes, I think it's all about knowing your patient as well. So I'll give it to you. I'll give that one to you. Yeah, so I think, you know, if you got to kind of know your patient, and, you know, then you can make the proper decision.
All right.
Good job.
Okay. So I just want to echo everyone. Thank you both so much for your bravery and for sitting up there. And I just want to say that, Charlie, you are going to be an incredible social worker based on your use of the words. You've already used the words cognizant, taking a step back, reading the room. You're doing great. I was wondering if you guys could comment. I think as a pediatric provider, something that we are thinking more and more about is this transition of people just like you who have pediatric conditions that maybe have been hospitalized in a pediatric facility for their whole life, and then they turn 21, and then where do you go? And I think, I was wondering if you guys could comment on what that transition has been like for the two of you, and any thoughts that you have on transitioning that care.
Can I go first?
Yeah, sorry.
Transitioning sucks, okay? It sucks. We've tried to transition, it's impossible. It is. I have been, and we tried to do, you know, the adult congenital program. I've been at UCLA and I've been at Stanford, and their adult congenital program is amazing. Now, it's just non-existent. I mean, the transition is the hardest thing I've ever had to do, and I've been overdosed on prednisone, okay? It is hard. It's non-existent. I mean, they wanted to transfer me to a different adult hospital in Fresno. They wouldn't take me. The physicians would not take me. They don't know how to treat us. When we come in, we're like a unicorn or a mermaid. They don't know us. They don't know our cases, and they get scared. And we get lost in the system. And that's when, you know, I know a lot of kids who have gotten lost in the system and who have passed away from what we're talking about right now. It's just non-existent, and it should be. Even at the hospital I've been going to since birth, the floors will not take me. The floors will not take me. I have to go ICU or go somewhere else. The floor will not take me because I'm an adult. What's the difference if I have congenital pediatric diseases? Yes, I might be a little bit mouthy, and yes, I might tell them what to do and how to do it and when to do it, but that's because it's my life. I've been living it for 24 years. I think I know how to take care of myself. And so, yeah, the transition, it's really hard. And my dad is trying to make a difference at Valley Children's and other places. And, you know, David Sine thankfully took my case, because if not, I don't think I would have a primary care complex physician handling me right now. I don't know where I would be. But I think Charlie is a little different because... Go ahead, Charlie.
Yeah, I think my case is a little bit different. So diagnosed at 13, grew up in Michigan, and so most of my initial care was at Detroit Children's. And I can recall being there for kind of extended stays for like week-long EEGs. And I'd be in one room, and my like roommate or the room next door would have infants. And I remember that just kind of blowing my mind, thinking, you know, I'm 13, I'm a teenager, like I'm this cool kid. And there's you know, there's a child next door. I would think that they would kind of separate us by age, but that didn't take place. And as I got older and had surgery at 17, I came out to UCSF and had surgery with Dr. Mitchell Berger, who's an amazing surgeon. And I had surgery through UCSF Bainoff, the Children's Hospital, but was put on an adult floor. And being 17 and being on the adult floor, I thought, well, yeah, I'm an adult now. You know, I'm 17. I'm cool. And the roommates on that floor then were about my grandparents' age. And so I thought, well, I don't know which I would prefer.
It's different.
And yeah. So it was kind of strange going from infant to grandparent. And thinking, well, why isn't there a young adult floor? And I know some hospitals, like out in Seattle, and I think maybe there's, I'm trying to think, maybe it's Indiana, another place, they actually have young adult, especially young adult oncology centers. And I have some friends who've gone there and say it's incredible, because I think there'll be age range like 16 to 25 or so maybe, and it's really nice to have that transitional space where there are other people like you who are kind of in that same developmental period and are kind of going through the same lifespan activities, and also just kind of in that same headspace, and they too don't want to be with infants and don't want to be with grandparents, and are able to share those experiences. So I know if I would have had that, that would have been really nice. Granted, I was also sleeping a lot after brain surgery, but it still would have been really nice to have. Now, how we're going to implement that is another story. And I think restructuring hospitals or restructuring entire floors to accommodate a group of patients who might not necessarily make up the majority of patients who are admitted is another problem. But I think it's definitely a conversation worth having. And it would be nice if adolescent young adult patients could try to be grouped together on floors. That way, you know, when we're up going for walks around floors, or when we're just kind of, you know, we peek our heads out and see who else is here, to see someone else who is around our age would be really reaffirming, I think.
We also need the physicians to kind of agree to that and to see us. And that is, it's very hard to get, you know, pediatric nurses to take as adults now. I mean, someone in the crowd, Marla is a nurse, and we mirror each other's diseases very well. Actually, we're like twins. I didn't know I had a twin. But she said, you know, she sees a 25-year-old and she's terrified of that patient because she is a pediatric nurse. So there also that conversation has been had in a lot of hospitals, and I know that, but I mean, and I know it's going to take a while because everything in the hospital is really slow, and it's on hospital time. But I think that you know, talking to physicians, talking to nurses, you know, maybe getting some adults in a pediatric hospital, getting some adult nursing there, getting, you know, so it has a lot of components to that as well.
It's all about the synergy.
Yeah.
Starting the conversations between the two groups.
Yes.
So, yes, thank you for waiting.
So my original question was very similar to the oncology nurse, but I wanted to get more specific because I've had this case twice. And not case, individual, beautiful case. Very individual, twice I had that. And it's more specific to you, Charlie, I think, because Rachel, I think I know where you're coming from. And that's when a child is going to be asymptomatic for a certain amount of time. Do they need to know that they have this life-limiting thing? Most parents would be like, there's no need to tell them. I don't want to tell them. You said you had a number of years where you were really, really frightened and nothing was happening to you in a physical state. Would you have rather not known?
Yeah. Well, I think so. I was having seizures during that time period, and I was getting MRIs every 6 months to still monitor that tumor. And so there was very much so, there was medical care in a sense going on in that time to make sure that the tumor wasn't growing at a more rapid pace than it was, because it was a slow-growing tumor. And so I think my medical care was very much so a center point in my life in a way that I didn't want it to be, because I was playing tennis, I was playing soccer, I was an athlete, and then all of a sudden I started taking all these seizure medications that were slowing me down and making me nap all the time, and the tile was coming up on the floor in the classroom, and I was playing tennis, and I felt like I was drunk, and I didn't know what drunk was at 13, but I felt like that. I imagined that that's what that would be, and so I knew that there was something wrong with me medical-wise, and I think more of that came from what I saw in my parents and how I saw them responding. And I think children are a lot more perceptive than we give them credit for, especially 3-, 4-, and 5-year-olds. And so I think regardless of what we tell them, they're going to know that there's something going on. And this is also kind of family values and family, just different how families want to kind of take this on and how this is going to change families on their own, and also disease dependent and disability dependent. And so it's really hard to say an overarching recommendation of sorts because this was my life and this was my experience. And I really can't speak to the experience of everyone. I can speak for brain tumors in it. I can speak for low grade, slow growing brain tumors and people with seizures who also happen to be in middle school. but it's tough to say, you know, if this was someone who had osteogenesis imperfecta and somehow didn't know that was what they had, and their parents chose not to tell them from when they were born till then, I think that would be a very different situation.
And if I can just follow up, because you are about at that age, Charlie and Rachel, you just went through that. When we're transitioning from an 18 to a 19-year-old, so our ethical consideration of the parents now, say at 19 years old, if there's a test coming up, important thing, cath, the very initial approach to you, would you have preferred it to be you alone and then bring your parents in, or everybody together?
So I think my parents have always been a very integral part of my medical care, and they've always helped me balance that, and they've always helped me in terms of whether it was finding who was in network with insurance. I've always been very fortunate and very privileged to have insurance and to be able to find that. And so even though now I live in a separate state from my parents, and once I started college, I was going to my medical appointments without them, and I was making these appointments without them. So now my medical kind of care is different than when I was younger. If there was something, if we were all still in the same state, I would certainly still be, we would all still be going to the appointments together. I think because it's very important to have another ear there. And now that I'm not in the same state, I always have, my roommate will go with me or a friend will go with me. And I certainly appreciate having an extra voice there. And I think it's very important to have someone else there to advocate for you. Especially if something comes up that's unexpected, like, oh my gosh, you had a recurrence in your scan and I was not expecting that to be there that day. And so having someone there to take extra notes. So I think for me personally, having that close medical relationship with my parents, I've always appreciated that. However, other family dynamics are very different. And so other young adults or other adolescents do not have that same parent-child relationship, and so they might never, you know, have their parents at these appointments, or that might never have even been that way from the start.
Can I elaborate real quick? Okay. As I learned from camp and, you know, having a ton of, my parents are all in medicine, not physicians, but they all work. My sister's husband is a physician. My sister works at Chalk. So anyway, what I've learned and what I've heard is that when you are a complex patient, having another ear or two when you're getting any type of information, good or bad, you don't necessarily hear everything that's coming at you. And so it's nice to have others, you know, next to you to receive that information. And I might have not heard something, and my dad or my mom might have heard something. And so it's nice to have, for me, it's nice to have the second ears and brains and all that stuff. So, yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Kathy.
Hi. So I'm actually asking this question on behalf of my son, because I called him and said that both of you were on this panel. He's 17 years old. He wants to know about dating while dying. So he's very interested in how do you develop relationships? When do you reveal to people that you have a certain health condition? So can you talk to us about that?
Yeah, that's a great question. And we were briefly kind of talking about this right before we came in the room, actually, in the hallway. And for me personally, I think, I take anti-seizure medication 3 times a day, and I require a certain number of hours of sleep so that I don't have seizures. And I am generally kind of a sleepy, more like calm, laid back person because of the seizure medication. And so it's not uncommon for me to seem like I'm like extra sleepy all the time because of that. And so my health is a very central part of my life. And so getting to know me very quickly involves getting to know my health backstory, as well as a quick Google search of my name. Also would pull up my health information. So kind of learning that information about me is really imperative to knowing like who I am. But I also see the other side of that, where that's not the first thing that I want someone to know about me. And that's not something that I would want to bring up on a first date, or would want to be the reason why like someone's attracted to me or wants to date me. it's a tough kind of road to walk, where you want people to know what is going on with your health. If you have to back out of a date or aren't feeling well a certain day, so you can't go or have to reschedule. But you also want to be a normal young adult and go do the same things that your peers are doing. And so I think everyone is different as well in when and how they reveal their health history. I think I am definitely one of the more open people about my health, running like a Twitter chat related to brain tumors, posting articles about different health research on Facebook and other things. So it's really not hard to find information about my health quite quickly. But I think people definitely vary in their openness about that.
I'm a little different than Charlie. Okay, I met my fiance now on Match.com. And yeah, my dad actually told me to sign up, so. It was 3 years, being in, yeah, anyway. And I actually put out but I did say that I'm a sick adult, and, I have had issues. Not everything, because then you get creepers, But I did say that I am a sick adult. And yes, I got some creeps, and I got a lot of dads that were like, oh, my child has CHD. I'm like, oh, gosh, okay, nice. I'm like, cool, do you want to go on it? No, nope, no. But I actually put it on there. And what I found, because I had recurrent C. diff for, now I have it for about two and a half years. I'm on the better side of C. diff, thank you. I have a port, so I have a central line in. I've had a central line in for about accessed nonstop for 2.5 years. So, showing up with a central line and, a really bad stomach ache on a first date isn't exactly, sexy. Sorry, Dad. Sorry. But he understood and he thanked me because he knew all the information before we went on a date. It wasn't a surprise to him. It wasn't, and I did not elaborate on the Match.com, okay? I did not put everything, but I did put enough to be like, you really want to go there? I mean, I'm a handful, and I didn't think it was fair not to say something, because this is me. This is my life. This is my reality, and I am a full-time patient, but I'm also Rachel, so... Hey, he loved me, so. And we also spent one month after dating in the ICU. So, and he was there every day, so I don't know why he stayed, but yeah, so.
Frequently when I tell people that I work in hospice and palliative care, the first thing they say is, that is so depressing, I don't know how you do it. And I actually say to them, well, paradoxically, it's actually very life-affirming. Just listening to you and watching Claire's blog, it's very obvious that you are all filled with life. Mm-hmm. And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about how your disease has impacted the values of your life, but more importantly also, I'd like to know how your disease and your dealing with it has impacted your contemporaries who may otherwise think they're immortal. The very end, just wondering how your illness and your ability to deal with it has impacted friends of yours who may otherwise, at their age, think that they are immortal.
Well, I could, it's, oh, sorry. It's impacted my, well, I was born with it, so I was never healthy, unlike Charlie here, I was never healthy, but, I guess friends thought I was really weird when I couldn't run. They were jealous in PE and stuff. I'm like, I would give anything to run. I'd give anything to do everything that everybody else could, because it sucks being, not the normal. I couldn't go to, I couldn't finish high school on campus. I had to go to, I had to go on home hospital, and Then I had to leave Fresno State because I was so sick. And I did join a sorority at Fresno State, Delta Gamma, so. Yeah, any DGs out there? No, just kidding. I'm just kidding.
Oh, woo!
But they didn't understand. They didn't know why I didn't go to every single Monday night meeting. Well, because I need to sleep, and I need like 14 hours in order to, you know, get up and go to class the next day. Or I was sick because I have an immune deficiency, and I'm living in a dorm where there's nasty germs, and it's disgusting. But so a lot of people did not understand. And I found out who my real friends were. And my entire family, I think it's impacted our entire family in a positive way, but also a negative way. My sisters felt very, very neglected when I was born because I was at UCLA most of the time when I was born. My mom found out she was pregnant when my sister was 4 months old. So we're only 13 months apart. So my sister's second year, my parents, they don't remember my sister's second year. They have no idea. And my oldest sister had to become my mom, and she was 5 years old. So it's a blessing in disguise, but I rather have all of these issues than anything else because it's a gift. I mean, it's a curse and a gift, but I mean, I don't know if I answered your question. It's a both negative and a positive. So I don't know, did I answer? No. Charlie will answer your question. There you go, Charlie, go ahead.
Yeah. I think that the perspective that I have because of having a brain tumor, because of having these seizures, and I've also had back surgery, living with pain and with like suffering and like living in like the messiness of it all, I think that it's something that not a lot of other young adults really think about. Most other people my age are concerned about things that I would consider to be trivial. And that's kind of stereotypical to generalize like that, because that's not true for everyone. But my friends who, I've been very fortunate to always have a lot of friends and to always have friends who have stood by me, but isolation is really one of the biggest problems amongst the adolescent and young adult cancer community. I've been lucky enough to have friends throughout all of this, and I think my friends have learned from being with me that there are people in life who are not always able to do the same things that they are, who are not always able to think the same way that they think, who would never consider doing the things that they do, whose life is completely different than theirs for different reasons. And I think that those are also very general thoughts that can be applied to a lot of different people for a lot of different reasons at any age. But I mean, it's just something that I consider like my health to be something that has like happened to me, but has also happened for me. And there are a lot of days where, like, if it's like a bad seizure day, life is like terrible that day. That's a terrible day for me. But the following day is a day that I'm reminded where, wow, I have the use of my right hand and arm again, and I can actually go and ride my bike to class, and I can finish that assignment I was working on, and I can. I'm reminded that I can do so many of the things that I wasn't able to do the day before because of that seizure. And I'm also reminded how fluctuating our health can be. And so I think that even I take my health for granted now that I'm 4.5 years since that brain surgery. And going into my surgery, I was told that I probably wouldn't be talking again afterwards. The tumor was in my left insula, which is tucked in between the frontal and temporal lobes, right by the Broca's area, which essentially controls speech and language. And being a very outgoing person and really liking talking, I was very concerned about that. And I was very worried about what kind of future I would have if I couldn't talk, which is very ableist of me now in hindsight. But I didn't really know what my future would look like, and now still being able to talk, I'm really just kind of amazed at how I can still do everything that I could do before with this big chunk of my brain missing. And so it's really incredible what the human brain and what our bodies can do.
I want to elaborate.
I just know we're running short on time. These panels, they could just go on all day. But I mean, there's so many questions. And so I apologize to you, those of you that we didn't get to your questions. But I did promise our group that I was going to end with one question. I actually warned them ahead of time. And so very quickly, we've got about 3 or 4 minutes. It's a two-parter. The first part is, what is your superpower? Because I happen to know both their superpowers. And it's kind of a running joke between all of us. Claire Wineland would like you to know that her superpower is that she can sense rain long before it ever hits. And more importantly, what would you like everyone here, if they walk away only remembering one thing from our conversation today, what would you like them to know?
You want me to go? I'll go. Okay, what is our superpower? I can walk through walls. No, I'm just kidding. I can actually detect wildfires up to miles and miles away. I think the furthest one I actually detected was 25 miles away I have one lung, okay? I am very sensitive to anything in the air, okay? Yeah, so I was actually in the car, and I'm like, do you guys feel that? My parents were like, what are you doing? Rachael, are you having a because I have non-epileptic seizures. I'm like, no, do you feel that? They're like, what are you talking about? I go, there's a fire. There's a fire somewhere. And they're like, no, Rachael, I think you're just, you just need to breathe. But okay, so that's, yeah, I could detect wildfires. So if you guys ever need, okay. And then what can you guys take away from this? Listen, 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 listen. Before you tell us what you're gonna do, listen to us, because we are individuals, cases, and we are individuals, and we want to be heard as individuals. We do not want to hear about, oh yeah, you've had the same case. You have never had the same case. I'm gonna tell you that right now, never. So that's what I want you to take away. Listen, and I really hope you enjoyed us. So that's another one.
I would have to say that my superpower also relates to the rain. I have 4 plates and 8 screws over here, so when it's gonna rain, they all jet out. So if you're worried about the rain, just come and ask me, and I'll let you know. I'll let you take a feel. You can feel it. As far as what I would want you to take away, I suppose it would be when you're talking to your pediatric patients about hospice or palliative care, anything related to that, I would say ask early, ask often, and ask gently on the topic.
So I have to say that we are really honored to have you guys both here. Thank you. You should also know that the conversation does not have to end here. Rachael and Charlie have both graciously agreed to be part of our office hours.
Please come.
So if you would like to carry on this conversation, we invite you to join us right here in this room at one of the tables. And again, thank you so much for just being part of this.
Okay, guys, guess what I did this year? For the first time in my entire life, I was hospital-free for 1 year. Because of concurrent care, my nurses and Dr. David Sein right there. Oh, and my parents and fiance. But no, 1 year, my entire life, I've not gone 1 year without being in the hospital. So thank you. And for those of you that may not know what concurrent care is actually where you are able to enroll in hospice, get hospice treatment while continuing on with your curative treatment. It's one of the incredible programs we have available to children and to some young adults here in California. And so, again, stay part of the conversation. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
So good.